Of course, the difficult issue for today is, of course, the whole concept of gifting Maria and Sirin. And the fact of the matter is that in the culture that we have been raised in, and I am a part of this culture like everybody else, this is a topic that is simply impossible to talk about without some type of bias. And the fact of the matter is that we are all biased in one direction, and that is we believe the Prophet to be a prophet. That is a legitimate bias. It's not a bad bias, right? And therefore, we will automatically view everything that he has done as being something that is permissible and sanctioned by Allah, at least for the time and place, even if it's not in our times, because there are some things that we can say are permissible back then, but now the Ummah has agreed to move on, and this is one of those issues, as I will come to. So if you believe that the Prophet was a prophet, and that is our belief, then we accept that these things were morally permissible. And if you don't believe this, then it's not my job to really convince with regards to the story of Maria. And the fact of the matter is that no amount of sugarcoating removes this reality, that Maria and her sister Sirin, they were not wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of course, Sirin was not. She became the servant of the concubine of Hassan. They were not wives, but they were milkul yamin. They were milkul yamin, and it does appear we know pretty much for a fact that she later on converted to Islam, but she was not a Muslim when she came. And in our Sharia, one cannot take a Muslim as a milkul yameen. That this is not something that is allowed, that a person who is a Muslim, we don't take them as abid or jawadi and then make them milk yameen. So she comes as a Christian and she converts at some later unspecified time. We do not know when that time is. And she is very much what the Bible itself calls a concubine. This is the term that the Bible itself has. Now, we as Muslims like to point out that whenever a Christian or a Jewish person says, oh, how could your prophet have so many wives and a concubine? Immediately our response is what? Look at Solomon, look at David, look at so-and-so, look at so-and-so. The fact of the matter is that the asl or the basic ruling is that the biblical prophets had multiple wives and most of them had concubines. The Bible mentions Abraham and Moses. Of course, David and Solomon. I mean, David has over 700. Solomon has over 1,000. This is according to the Bible. Over 1,000 ladies between wives and concubines put together. Over 1,000. So we point out, how can you criticize our Prophet for having one for most of his life? For more than 25 years of his life, he literally had one. And then in the last few years, when he was in his 50s and 60s, he married 9. How can you compare 9 to 900 or 1,000? So we point this out, and that's a valid point to make to a Christian or a faithful Christian or Jew. But the problem is, in our times, there are few faithful Christians and Jews, and they are also being eliminated from the picture, and more people are turning agnostic, and they have no problem criticizing these biblical figures as well. And so with them, you really cannot quote the past at all, because they will say that's also wrong what they did. Okay, and to that person, all that we can say, and this is the max, as much as we can say, is that that was a different world and a different time and a different place and a different custom and a different role. And people across the globe had different views about this notion. And while I was doing my research today, I actually came across a Jewish website, Q&A, like we have Islam Q&A, they have another equivalent, and a questioner is asking the rabbi that, how can I understand that Solomon used hundreds of thousands of slaves to build the temple? Doesn't this go against, you know, humanism and being nice and whatnot? Now, he's not asking about the slave girls, he's asking about slaves, because the Bible says that he used 100,000 slaves to build the grand temple. So this man is saying, I feel disgusted, and how can I be a Jew after this? How could our prophet have used, he's talking from himself's perspective, you know, all of these slaves. So this rabbi, his name is Rabbi Perry Rank from New York, he responds, and this is basically a response we can give, that the thing about history is it does tend to be brutal, and it strips us about our most cherished illusions about the past. So whenever we delve into history, we have to approach it cautiously, knowing that we might not return the same way we entered it. It's going to change our perception. Solomon was a great builder. And as such, he needed workers whom he secured through the institution of basically slaves or forced labor. This was not an uncommon practice in ancient times. So how shall we read this? Shall we read it as slavery or as employment? He's calling slaves employment because that's... Then he goes on. Has Solomon enslaved the masses or has he provided them jobs? We tend to think of slavery as an ultimate evil of sorts. Here's the point. But the fact is that this was an accepted form of labor for thousands of years. And our disillusionment with it is only recent, 300 years old. And only about 150 years, especially here in America. And then he goes on, the Torah has very extensive rules about how to treat slaves. The idea was to humanize and to civilize. And so he's basically defending the classical notion of slavery. This is a modern, you know, Jewish rabbi in New York. Because they have the same problem we do. And that is, the tradition clearly mentions slaves being used by the... Now, of course, we don't have any equivalent of 100,000 slaves being used in mass labor. We have one Maria that was treated very nicely. She has her own house. She's not working in the fields. But in the end of the day, from modern standards, this is not something that most modern humans would find palatable, right? And so we do need to, as much as we can, explain. So he says, this is not a defense of slavery. And I have to agree with everything he says here. I, like you, am a child of the anti-slavery movement of modern times. Meaning we're living in modern times where everybody has agreed we should be anti-slavery. But let's realize that once upon a time, that wasn't the notion in history. And to read what goes on in ancient times through our contemporary eyes, and then to judge it, is really not fair to our ancestors. This is what the rabbi is saying. You cannot look through the lens of 2014 as you look at 620 CE and then expect them to have everything like we did. The world was a very different place and everybody accepted it. And this is really harsh to say, but even the slaves of the time accepted it. That was the way that they were. And again, this is not a defense of slavery, but it is what... Now, here's another thing that I have to say here, and that is that the way that the slavery has existed in America in the 1800s is perhaps the most brutal manifestation of this institution in the history of humanity. That, realistically speaking, the way that America used slaves, imported them, caught free people, and brought them here, and used them worse than cattle and animals, and mistreated them and considered them to be inhumane. Even the ancient Greeks were better to their slaves than this reality. So one of the byproducts of being so harsh towards slaves was the anti-abolitionist movement came out of that, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. But the point is that we need to understand, and this is not sugarcoating, this is a fact, that slavery did not exist in Islamic lands the way that it existed in America. That's for sure. This is not to sugarcoat. There was slaves. Of course there were slaves. But, and I have a number of quotes, but we don't have time to get into them. But it is very true, historically speaking. And there are quotes that I can bring to you. Maybe we'll have another talk about this, historically speaking. That the first Europeans that visited Ottoman lands and visited Muslim lands and interacted with basically Muslims, they were amazed at how the slaves were treated in Muslim lands compared to how they're treated in European lands. So they're amazed at how gentle, how kind the slave... One of them marks, the slave speaks back to the master that, you know, cut back my work or whatever. I mean, he'll actually argue with the master. And we know from our Islamic history that some slaves even became kings. The Mamluk dynasty, which was the most prestigious dynasty that fought against the Mongols, right? Genghis Khan's hordes, or the great grandson of Genghis Khan. The Mamluk, what does Mamluk mean? It's called the slave dynasty. Literally, Mamluk means slave. And this dynasty was a dynasty of slaves who eventually rose to power and became the Khulafa. And they ruled over the Muslim world for almost 500 years up until the advent of Napoleon Bonaparte in 1792. I mean, it's really bizarre. Napoleon fought the Mamluks. Napoleon's fighting with guns, the Mamluks are fighting with swords. That's one of the reasons why they lost, okay? And that was the beginning of modernity. Muhammad Ali Pasha of Egypt came, and then modernization began because the Mamluks were destroyed. Point being that who were the Mamluks? They were a slave dynasty, okay? So In the end of the day, yes, we can add all of these points. There's only so much rationalization that I can do, only so much sugarcoating. If somebody wants to find fault with what happened, then honestly, this is the perspective of 2014 being back projected onto 610. There's nothing I can do about that. Okay? But I, as a Muslim who believes this man to be a prophet of Allah, I accept this was acceptable for the time and the place. And we also have to add here, this is compounded by the fact that in modern times we have these extremist groups that are now starting this whole notion of entrapping and basically conquering innocent women and then making them into slaves, right? We have the Boko Haram, we have the ISIS, we have all of this. So this obviously complicates it. And you then have people saying, oh look, they're basing this on the Prophet. I mean, this is ludicrous, because what Boko Haram is doing is haram. Because, why is this? Because, well, many reasons. The most obvious one, the Sharia completely and uncategorically forbids taking a free person and making them into a slave. There is a channel to become a slave, and that is prisoners of war who are not ransomed off. Okay? It is absolutely uncategorically haram, like what Boko Haram has done, is to invade a Christian village and take schoolgirls in broad daylight and then make them into slaves. Or what ISIS is doing with the Yazidi families. What wrong have they done? Where is the sin or the crime? Where is the jihad being waged? Who is the Khalifa? Where are the prisoners? This is complete haram. So we're not even, you know, there's no comparison at all with what is happening in modern times, what happened in the past. And also, of course, there's another point, and that is that scholars of our era have agreed that slavery is now a thing of the past. Just like in other faith traditions where, yes, there were times when slavery was practiced and they justified it. But now, in the era that we live in, I don't know of any scholar of our tradition. I don't know of a single alim that is calling for a return to slavery.